Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. Wassalamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. Amma ba'du fa'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Allahu waliyul ladhina amanu. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wassalamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Anytime that there is a battle that is about to happen, one of the first things that each side will do is send out a scouting party, or spies basically. And the reason they do this is to find out about the enemy, their number, their strength, how they're set up, what supplies they have, where their weaknesses are. And obviously, once you know the enemy, once you understand the enemy, then you are better equipped to fight against them. So in order for us to also fight against the enemies that are waging war against us, which we discussed before, that the inner enemy is our nafs, and the enemy about, or the outer enemy, is shaytan. So we need to understand a little bit about each of them. In particular, we need to understand how they try to attack us. And by understanding that, it will allow us to defend ourselves better. So the easiest way to understand the nafs is to take the example of a child. The nafs is essentially a small child. And because it itself is a small child, what it wants for us is that we also remain children, that we remain, i.e., immature, that we never become the full human being that we can. And this is something inherent in man, that they generally, if they're going down, they want to take down other people with them. This is a weakness in man. That when they are going down, they don't want to go down alone. They want to take somebody with them. So this is what the nafs does. The nafs is going down and it knows it, and it doesn't want to go down alone. And the only one it has is you. Right? Shaitan can go to somebody else. Your nafs can't go anywhere. Your nafs is your nafs. It can't just decide to flip over to somebody else. So it's stuck. It's stuck with you and you are stuck with it. So like a child, the nafs will generally focus on the immediate reward. It's not very strategic. It does not have long-term planning. It simply sees something that it wants and then it pushes you to get it. That's it. Very simple. Very straightforward. And so this is just like a child. If you ever see that a child gets in his mind that he wants a certain toy, that's it now. That's just going to stay in his head. You can say, oh, what about this toy? No, no, I want that one. Oh, what about this one? It's even better. No, no, I want that one. Oh, what about this Lego? I said, no, no, I want that one. He gets fixated on one single thing. And the nafs gets fixated on one single thing, and it keeps coming at you until you give in. And this is what happens to the parents who are in the toy store and the kid just won't let up. Say, fine, just take it, get it. Be done with it. There's only so much that we can take. And the nafs knows this. The nafs knows that we are weak. It knows that there is only so much that we can take. Because as we are interacting with children all around us, what is the nafs doing? It's taking notes. It's watching. And it sees, you know what? He cried 4 times and then his dad gave in. I'm going to cry 4 times and then dad's going to give in. This is exactly what the nafs does. It just looks for those small little cues. Things that we ourselves do, and then it uses that against us. And this is what a little child will do too. When you tell your child, oh no, 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 you're too young to have soda, what do they say? Oh, Baba, you have soda. I saw you drinking a can of Pepsi. Simple things, and they turned it against you. And this is what those who have children, they know better. So just like a child wants immediate satisfaction, our nafs wants immediate satisfaction. Just like a child is immature, our nafs is immature. It does not have the ability to understand the decisions that it makes. You know, they've started doing studies now on the brains of teenagers, in particular 16-year-olds, right? Because when you're 16, you get your driver's license. And if you look at the accident rates for 16-year-olds, it's like, you know, 60, 70, 80%, some crazy number like this. Pretty much guaranteed, you give a 16-year-old a car, he's going to get into an accident. Odds are in that favor. And this is why, you know, the insurance for them and all the premiums and all the things that go with it go up incredibly. When that kid gets to 18, that number drops significantly. And so what the scientists wanted to figure out is what's going on. What is it in that 1 or 2 years? You know, is he really getting that good of a driver in 2 years? Is it really that much difference between a 16 and 18-year-old? And so they did all these tests on the brain, and they watched what happens. And what they realize is that there are essential parts of the mind that are still forming for a 14-year-old, for a 15-year-old, for a 16-year-old, for a 17-year-old. And those things form considerably as you get into 18, 19, and 20. And so what the conclusion that they drew is that basically 16-year-old can't help themselves. They just do not have the ability to make sound judgments in that situation. So you tell your 16-year-old, okay, you can go out, but no more than one other kid in the car with you. Because the more kids, the more distractions. So what does he do? He jam-packs it. 8 of his buddies. Right, all going out to get milkshake and french fries. And then what happened? They get into an accident. He knows better. It's not that he doesn't know better. There's something in his mind that causes him to make these poor judgments. So the nafs is immature in the same way. It makes rash decisions, and it doesn't realize the outcome of those decisions. And the reason it can do this is because it knows that you are there to take care of it, that you will bail it out of those situations, which is exactly what the kids do. The kids know in the end of the day, whatever I do, I may get yelled at and everything, but they're going to come get me. Right? My parents are going to come get me. They're going to take care of me. So the nafs is after immediate satisfaction. The nafs is immature. The nafs is insatiable. The nafs is insatiable. You know, we all like to have sweet things. We all like to have salty snacks. We all like to have these different things. But we have limits for the most part. So if I sit down in the morning and I give you, you know, 6 donuts, you're not going to be able to eat those 6 donuts. And if you do, you're going to get sick. You put a kid down in the morning and you put those 6 donuts and he will just devour them. He will just devour them. Yesterday my son was eating cereal and he was just mixing all the cereals together. Cookie Crisp, Trix, Corn Flakes, you know, like 4 or 5 different sugary cereals. And he's just eating it. He's just, you know, devouring it. So the nafs is the same way. It's insatiable. We think that, okay, if we just get that one thing that it wanted, that now we're going to be fine. What is it? 10, 15 minutes later, it sees something else. It sees a sign for the next tasty treat, and it wants it. It sees the next advertisement, the next commercial, and now it wants it. It sees the guy in the cubicle next to you. Well, what did he have? My donut doesn't have that filling in it. What happened? He wants it. And it just keeps going. So it's insatiable like that. And the problem is that the more you feed it, the more it wants. The more you feed it new things, the more it wants those new things. The more it sees the latest cookies and crackers and biscuits that are coming out, then it wants to try them. And then the first time you try it, now it got a taste of it. Now it's all over. Now it knows what that thing tastes like, and it's just going to remind you about it. This is what it does. It remembers what it was like. It remembers the sensory experience that you had eating that thing, and then it sticks it back in your mind when it wants it. This is what kids do. My son will do this. Oh, Baba, remember that time that we stopped and got french fries and how good they were, and they were all nice and warm and salty? He doesn't care that I remember. He wants french fries. This is his trick. This is his ploy to do it. So he tries to remind me that one time we had it and we had a good time eating them together. The nafs does the same thing. It's going to bring back that sensory experience and it's going to put it back in your mind and it's going to remind you, last time we had it, that thing was really, really good. Yeah, we knew then we shouldn't have had it and we know now we shouldn't have had it, but man, it was good. So this is what the nafs does. So the nafs wants immediate satisfaction. The nafs is immature. The nafs is insatiable. And the nafs is hypocritical. The nafs is very, very hypocritical. So that same thing that you were doing at home, now you come to the masjid and someone else is doing it, and all of a sudden, oh, look at that guy. He's in the house of Allah and he's backbiting, and you just spent the whole last 15 minutes backbiting on somebody. When the nafs sees something bad in others, it highlights it. And it highlights it so much that it tries to hide that thing inside of you and simply focus all your attention externally. And so what this causes us to do is we start to notice other people's faults when we have that same fault within us. So the nafs in this way is hypocritical. The same things that you are doing, it's going to point out in other people around you. And this is actually one of the ways that we can use the nafs against itself. Is that when you start looking at somebody and saying, oh man, that guy's arrogant, guarantee you, you're the one who's arrogant. He may also be, who knows? I'm not saying he's not. But it's a dead sure sign that you yourself have some arrogance inside of you. When you look at that person and say, oh man, look, he's so jealous of the other guy, that's a dead sure sign that you have jealousy within you. So the nafs wants immediate satisfaction, the nafs is immature, it's insatiable, it's hypocritical, and the nafs is shrewd. The nafs is very, very shrewd. It protects itself. And it knows that at some point you're going to try and subjugate it. It knows this. Because it's also sitting in the same bayans that you're sitting in. It's also listening to the same ulama that you're listening to. It's also listening to the same lectures that you're listening to. And it's learning all the tricks. So when the imam is saying we gotta subjugate our nafs, we gotta watch what we're eating, we gotta sleep less, we gotta speak less, it's taking notes. Oh man, what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? Can't let that happen. This is what it does. So the nafs is very, very shrewd. And the way that it protects itself is by making us think that everybody else is our enemy other than the nafs. Right, it comes in and whispers, yeah man, we gotta do something about that guy. We gotta help him. Right, buddy, buddy's up to you. And it focuses again, your attention outward. So what happens? Somebody does some small thing and we get in a fight with them. We get upset about it. We blow it out of proportion because the nafs is agitating us to do that. Are you gonna let him talk to you like that? Are you the husband? Are you the man or is she the man? Are you the wife or are you the husband? This is what it does, and it agitates us. We don't even realize it, and now we're, you know, 2-3 levels above where we were before. Somebody in the masjid says something. Who does that guy think he is? I've been coming here for 2 years. He just came here. Oh, get on him! And boom, we're, you know, attacking that person for no reason. So this is the shrewdness of the nafs. Now what we need to realize about the nafs is that it is actually a mix of good and bad. Unlike shaitan, which is 100% bad, from beginning to end, until the day of judgment and after, shaitan is 100% bad. The nafs is not 100% bad. Our children are not 100% bad. They are just slightly mischievous. Right? They're troublemakers. Right? They like to give us a rile. And so the same way that we love our children is in the sense the same way that we love our nafs. Because that same nafs that gets you to do things that you shouldn't be doing is that same nafs that can get you to do things that you should be doing. So the nafs is a mix of good and bad. When I was in, I think I was a sophomore in high school. So we had an English teacher who was a big stickler for spelling. He was very, very particular about spelling. And he was teaching his Shaykh in these books, so obviously he was very fine-tuned to the language, and he used to speak in a kind of snooty voice. And so he, from the very beginning, made this rule that every Friday is a spelling test. And you would just have 10 words on that spelling test. So every single Friday, from the first Friday to the last Friday. So the first week rolls around, he gives us the 10 spelling words. You know, everybody looks at it, we know a lot of the words, you memorize maybe a little bit, the ones you don't. Most people are getting 10 out of 10, 9 out of 10, 8 out of 10. Second week rolls around, same thing. He adds 10 to the list. No problem, you're there. Third week rolls around, now some people are getting 7s, 6s. By the 6th or 7th week, now there's 60, 70, 80 words piling up on you. So now, if there was randomly that one word you didn't know, and randomly the other word you didn't know, and now there's 3 or 4 that you don't know, and every week there's 1 or 2 words that you don't know, maybe 1 week you got lazy and you didn't study, now this thing that used to be simple and easy has become very difficult. And by the end of the year, you'd be hard-pressed, honestly, to find someone who's getting above a 3 or 4 on those spelling tests. There are just so many words, you know, and you just get sick of it at some point. You just kind of give up. But there were some people, a handful, 3 people actually in particular in that class, who from the beginning to the end just spent like 10 minutes every week, and they just memorized them. And they would just review from the back a little bit. And they were getting 10 out of 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 10. And then for the rest of us, it was this huge, every week it was just this painful, painful experience. Because he would get on you. And he would call out your name and say the word and be like, you can't even spell it. You know, like, what are you doing in 10th grade? Maybe I should send you back to freshman English. He was that kind of a guy, you know? So the point is that something small and simple that if we had controlled in the beginning, if we had spent 10 minutes every week, that was enough of your grade to basically ensure that you would get either a B or above in the class. Some of those 3 people, they didn't have to take the final exam. Because every week you get 10 out of 10. So the nafs, just like those exams, the nafs gets out of control very easily. Before you even realize it, it has now done all of these things to you. It has now pulled you into so many different things that it feels like it's impossible to pull out of it. And this is our mistake. This is the mistake that we make. You know, when we spoil our children, then we suffer for that for years and years and years. It's very hard when a kid becomes corrupted to get that out of him. Just like it's very hard when our nafs becomes, you know, so embroiled over us that now what do we have to do? We have to spend 3 days in the masjid. Then we have to come back, then we have to spend itikaf, then we have to sit on the musalla for half an hour every day, istighfar, salawat, keep in touch with the shaykh, right? All of these different things. And this is because we've allowed our nafs to get out of control. So the big question that a lot of people ask is, how do we get this fervor for the deen? How do we get that desire to stand on the musalla? How do we get it that our eyes open automatically for fajr? How do we get it that we want to be in the masjid for the first takbir of the prayer? That we like to come on Jummah early to the masjid? And so the answer to this lies in what we've been discussing for the past few days. Right? In particular, this system that we've been talking about. That you have the heart, and you have the nafs, and you have the mind. So basically, in the sound system, what happens, to remind ourselves, that the heart is sound. It wants us to wake up for fajr. It pushes out this idea to our mind. And then the nafs takes it and gives it action. Makes it actionable for us. The nafs pops our eyes open. It says, hey man, we gotta pray. Come on. What are you doing? The same way it says, hey man, we gotta get that donut. Come on. What are you doing? The exact same way that it does it. And the same way that we fall for it there, we'll start falling for it the other way. So this is why we don't have the fervor for the deen. One is that we've allowed our hearts to become encrusted over. And secondarily to that is we've allowed our nafs to take control. We were supposed to control the nafs, and we've allowed it to take control of us. So why is it then that we come into these gatherings and we get a boost? Right? Because if our heart is really encrusted over, if our heart is diseased and our nafs is ghalib over us, it's taking control over us, then why do we get these boosts? We shouldn't get those boosts then. If the system is not working, then how is it all of a sudden for a few minutes going into action? So to understand this, first take the example of an injection. Right? So we've all had an injection. So what does the doctor do? He fills up the needle with medicine. He decides where he wants to inject it. He uses the needle to penetrate the skin. When he gets the needle where he wants, he pushes down the plunger. It sticks the medicine in, and then what does he do? He pulls the needle out. And as soon as he pulls the needle out, the skin around that hole to where the medicine was going closes up. And now you can't even tell where exactly the needle went in, what was exactly the track that it went in, how deep did it go. So it sticks in the medicine, drops it where it wants to, and then it goes out. So what happens when we come in front of the ulama, in front of the mashayikh, is they essentially take out a needle, they fill it with the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they jab it into our heart. They push the plunger down, it goes into our heart, and then they pull it out. And now that hole has closed up now. So now for the next 2, 3, 4 days, we are getting the fervor, we are getting that boost off of that nur, off of that blessing that got into our heart. And it is out of the barakah of our ulama, out of their hard work, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows this to happen. But obviously now, once that injection's been made, it's closed up behind there now. It's not an open hole anymore. So you only have however long you have. For some people it's a week. Some people it's 2 weeks. Some people honestly it's the next day. The next day they get up for Fajr and then Dhuhr is gone. Right? Then Dhuhr is gone after that. So this helps to give you some idea of the condition of your heart before that. The condition of the heart that was extremely diseased, he's just going to make it maybe at a Fajr and that's it. The one who wasn't as sick, he might get it for a week. He might get it for 2 weeks. But eventually it's going to go away. Eventually it's going to get used up. That is basically energy for your iman. And as you exert it, as you get it for tahajjud, now you used up a portion of it. Then you get it for fajr, you used up a portion of it. Now you go to the masjid for dhuhr, you used up a portion of it. Now you read Quran, one juz, two juz, you used up a portion of it. And so the more and more actions that we do, then we basically use up this thing. So this is why we come to these talks, we come to different events, we sit in front of the mashayikh, and we get the boost, and then it goes away. So this is a natural thing that happens. You're going to get the boost, and it's going to go away. Until you bring the system in check, you're going to get the boost, and it's going to go away. So then how do we begin to control our nafs? How do we begin to bring our nafs into line with what we want it to do? And the easiest way, not the easiest, the most simple to understand is that you lay down hard and fast rules. If you've ever watched a bunch of children playing together, they inevitably start fighting over small, small things. So one child was playing with the truck, and the other kid grabbed it from him. So what does he do? He grabs it back. Then there's a pushing match, then there's a shoving match, and then there's crying. Now they come running upstairs. I was playing with the truck first, and he took it from me, and that's not fair, and this and that, and then they go on and on and on. Now if you were to ask that child before they started playing, okay, what are the rules about playing? He will tell you himself. No pushing, no shoving, we share, whoever had the toy first gets to play with it. And you can even ask them why. Why are those the rules? And they will tell you different answers. Oh, teacher taught us that. That's what a good Muslim does. That's what Ummi said we should do. That's the nice thing to do. Because what happens when you push? It hurts the other person. They can fall down. They don't like it. So they know the rules, and they even know the wisdom behind the rules. And the minute someone grabs the truck, what happens? Boom, he pushes back, he grabs the truck, and that kid's crying on the floor. This is what happened over and over again. You know, it's like those cartoons where they keep bashing each other over the head. Over and over again. This is what happens when the kids play. And this is the reason, is because they're just like the nafs. The nafs, all it wants, the nafs knows what it should be doing, what it shouldn't be doing. The nafs knows that it also has to be subservient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The nafs knows that our reason for being here is not the dunya, but it is the akhirah. But it just wants what it wants. And at that moment, even though it knows it, and even though it understands why, because if we don't fix ourselves, we're going to end up getting punished. And that's going to be a long, long torment. It understands all of these things. When it's just thinking in the moment, just like that kid. The minute somebody grabbed that truck from him, his whole world just got focused on that one event. That one emotion became so overpowering for him that that's all he could basically deal with. And so he reacts. He just reacts right away without thinking. So what do? You basically tell the child, no pushing, no matter what. And when they come running upstairs, and he said, and I said, and he took it, and he said, no. No pushing, no matter what. Time out, go sit in the corner, you go sit in the corner. And this is how kids learn. And then they get in their head that whatever happens, if we do this again, we're going to get in trouble. So then you know what they do after that? Because they're tricky. The next time it happens, someone grabs a truck from him, he pushes him down. Now he'll go to him and say, okay, no, you take it, just don't tell mama. Because now he doesn't want to get in trouble. Now he knows the rules have been laid down. But that only works when you are firm on those rules. Because they're going to come and, no, I'm sorry, I won't do it again, please. Okay, then it's all over. The minute you said okay, then it's all over. You have to stand firm. So this is how you deal with the nafs. And obviously, it's not an easy thing to do. Anybody who has children, when the kids come and they're crying, it's not easy to stand firm at that point. So it's not easy when the nafs is coming to you and it cries, just like your children cry. It knows all those soft, it knows just the right buttons to push. So it's not easy to do it, but that's the way you control the nafs. And this is why the mashayikh used to do the things they used to do. This is why they used to like bread so much. Because bread was easily portioned out. One slice of bread, that's it. If we say, okay, one bowl of salin, right? All of a sudden that bowl is getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Right? One plate of rice. All of a sudden that plate is getting bigger and bigger. It's getting stacked higher and higher and higher. There's a subjectivity to it. And this is what the ulama realized a long time ago. Is when you leave these little bits of leeway, then the nafs just goes right in there and it takes advantage of it. So they would just have one loaf of bread. And they would just cut it into 30 pieces. And just, that's it. One piece a day. That's it. That's all they would do. Hard and fast. I don't care how hungry you are. I don't care if you pass out on the floor. All we're getting is one piece of bread. That's it. And so obviously this is not necessarily something that all of us would be able to do. Right? And so we've talked about this throughout the session. So there's another way that you can tackle the nafs. There's another way you can tackle the nafs. You know when these bears go into hibernation, what they do is they basically stuff themselves before the winter sets in, and then they go find a quiet place, quiet dark place, and they go to sleep. And the only reason they wake up is because they get very, very hungry. When the hunger gets so much that they can't sleep through it anymore, that's when their eyes open. And so you can imagine, you know, what their appetite is at that point. So what happens? Anything that's near the bear when it gets up at that point in time, what does it do? It just grabs it and devours it. Whatever it is, any small animal, whatever is by it, it's just going to grab it and it's going to devour it because it's so hungry. And it's cranky, right? Because somebody woke it up. So we have a hibernating bear within us. And this hibernating bear is our ruh, our soul. If you can wake up your soul, when its eyes open, it's hungry, it's going to grab the first thing it sees, and the first thing it's going to see is the nafs, and it's just going to swallow it. And khalas, done. Done deal. Except it's not that easy to wake up the soul. It's not that easy to wake up the soul. But the way to begin the act of waking up the soul is to focus on the heart. Because one of the main constituents, obviously our soul is attached to all the different parts of our body. But in particular with our qalb, our spiritual heart, it has a very special attachment, a very special relationship with the soul. And so the quickest way to wake up the soul is to focus on the heart. And the quickest way to focus on the heart is to do the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To do the istighfar, to do the salawat, to read Quran. To do those things that bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more and more that we do this, the more and more that our heart wakes up. The heart wakes up, the ruh wakes up, the ruh wakes up, and then it subjugates the nafs. Because look, the nafs is an invisible enemy. So how do you fight an invisible enemy? You find someone who can see him. Right? It's simple. You can't see him, you find somebody who can see him. The ruh lives in that same realm. Now you've got something on an even playing field. And the nafs knows this. Just like it knows all these other things, the nafs knows it, and that's when it'll give up. When it sees that you've made that effort to wake up your ruh, then it knows you're serious, and then it will give up. And then it will become the nafs that is content with the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is content with the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was a little bit about the nafs. And that completes the three things that we're discussing in this system about the heart, which we started with, and then we moved to the qalb. I'm sorry, the mind, the aql, and then we moved to the qalb, and then we went to the nafs. But the nafs has a buddy, this invisible buddy, so we might as well just discuss him a little bit too before we finish up, right? So this is a shaitan that we talked about. Now, unlike the nafs, where at some point you get it on your side. At some point, the nafs helps you get to where you need to go. Shaytan never comes onto your side. Shaytan never comes onto your side. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about him in the Quran. Because if you look at history, what you find is that there are enemies and then there are peace treaties. Then there are enemies and then there are peace treaties. I mean, look at Germany. Right? How much trade we have, what kind of relations, diplomatic relations we have with Germany. We used to be at war with them, World War II, because of Germany. And now look, they're our buddy. We go there, they come here, no big deal. So that's one kind of enemy. And then there's the enemy that never becomes your friend. Even if he signs a peace treaty with you, it's just tricking you. It's just tricking you. And that's shaitan. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he is your enemy and keep him as an enemy. So Allah is saving us the growing pains of learning that lesson the hard way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saving us from signing a treaty with shaitan, thinking that, okay, now he's going to leave us alone for 10 years, and then he turns around the next day and he gets us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to keep him as an enemy, which means until the end of time, shaitan is going to be our enemy. And this is a war that never ends. He is going to keep coming and keep coming, and we will have to keep repelling him and keep repelling him. So who was Shaytan? I mean, where did this Shaytan come from? So Shaytan's proper name, quote unquote, is Iblis. Right? Shaytan is a general term for all of these mischievous little beings. And the head of their king of their realm is Iblis. So Iblis was a jinn. And he was someone who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excessively. Excessively. And he was extremely knowledgeable in the deen. Extremely knowledgeable in the deen. And it was because of this worship and because of this great knowledge that he had that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would allow him to come up to the realm of the angels around the arsh. Otherwise it was just the angels and this one jinn that would be allowed to come into that realm. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. And he made him his khalifa. And he ordered everybody there to prostrate. And this is how the command came upon Shaytan. Because Shaytan was in that gathering at the time. So when the command went out, it went out to everybody who was there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded everybody who was there to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. So they all did, except Iblis. He didn't. He refused. He refused. He became arrogant. And because of that, he became from the disbelievers. just in an instant, in this short period of time. Disobeyed, arrogant, disbeliever. This is the pathway. This is where arrogance leads you. Arrogance uncontrolled will always lead you to disbelief. It rips away the iman. So then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, well, why aren't you prostrating? Why aren't you prostrating? What does he say? أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ. That I am better than him. That's why. Prostration is a sign of showing respect to somebody who's above you, and he's not above me, so why should I prostrate to him? I'm better than him. And then he explains why. Right? Everybody wants the dalil. Shaitan's giving you his dalil. Okay? That I was created from fire, and he's created from dirt. And everybody knows fire beats dirt. So that's it, simple. And so now Iblis becomes Shaitan, and he is accursed until the end of time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is getting ready to throw him out of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is getting into his jalal, that how can he, with this arrogance, stand up and say these things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses Shaitan, and then Shaitan does a very, very interesting thing. He asks for a respite from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He asks for a respite. And the respite that he asks for is that he be given until the day of judgment to do whatever he wants to do. That's why Shaitan is around. He asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's fine, you're going to kick me out of Jannah, that's fine, I'm the accursed, that's fine, but I want until the day of judgment, and I'm going to show you what I'm going to do to your servants. I'm going to show you that I'm better. Because this is what his whole thing was, that I'm better. I'm better than man. So this is what he wanted to prove now. And now the really interesting thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his request. He basically made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted that dua from him. So now what does Shaitan do? He got his respite. Right away he goes to work. Right away he goes to work. If your enemy is tirelessly preparing against you, then you need to do the same thing. The minute they start their preparations, you better start your preparations. So Shaitan didn't waste a moment. He didn't waste a moment. And so what does he do? Now he starts thinking, how am I going to get these guys? Now obviously he can't do anything to Allah, and he knows that. And he knows that the angels are 100% obedient. They just proved that. Right? So Shaitan knows this. He knows these two things. So now who's left? Who's left? Adam alayhi salam. So now he sets his eyes on him. And even more for him, because that's the one who got him into trouble in the first place. Everything was fine and dandy till Adam came along. So now Shaitan sets his sight on him. That I'm going to get him. And I'm going to show that I was better. I'm going to prove myself. To who? This is the strange thing. The whole story is very strange. He's going to prove himself to Allah. Why didn't you bow down and prove yourself? It was his arrogance that stopped it from happening. It was his arrogance that stopped it from happening. So now he's going to prove himself to Allah. This is what he's setting out to do. So now they've disobeyed Allah, and Shaitan disobeyed Allah. But what did they do? When they realize what happens, they start crying. They start crying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Their intention was pure, but the mistake that they made was thinking that the goal was Jannah. The goal is not Jannah. The goal is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you look at the seerah, you will see this theme coming over and over again. That all the Prophet of Allah cared about was the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all he cared about. So this was the mistake that they made. So what happened? They're both expelled. And then what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does is he doesn't put them down together on the earth, he actually separates them by a great distance. So now you can imagine they were in Jannah, in the best of situations, and now they are alone on the earth, a strange place, no clothes, not understanding is really what's happening. And so what do they do again? They start crying, and they turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in different narrations it mentions how long they were crying for, but they cried for a very, very long time. For a very, very long time. So they cried, and they cried for a very, very long time. And eventually, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them for what they did. And then He reunited them on the Jabal of Rahmah. When people go for Hajj, they always shari close to Jabal. That's the Jabal Rahmah. That's why it's called Jabal Rahmah. Because that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Rahmah descended upon them and the forgiveness came. So this is our little buddy Shaytan. This is his story. So let's look at a few things. Let's take a few lessons from this story. There are a number of things that Shaytan was the first person to do them. He was the trendsetter. He was the modern Muslim, quote unquote. Okay. So the first thing that he did is Shaytan was the first person to break ijma. So ijma means consensus. And it is one of the ways that we derive Islamic law. Not we, but the ulama who do that. That if everybody agrees on something, then it's accepted to be as part of the Sharia. So Shaytan was the first person to break ijma. What ijma? Ijma of the angels. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to bow down, they all bowed down. Except Shaytan. Except Shaytan. So he was the first person to break ijma. Shaytan was the first person to perform qiyas. Qiyas means juristic analogy. And it is another one of the four ways that the ulama derived Islamic law. So what qiyas did he do? It's called qiyas sayyi'at. A bad qiyas. A bad analogy. He said, I'm made of fire. He's made of dirt. I'm better than him. The mistake that he made here, in order to understand this, we need to first go back for a minute and understand that there are three ways that we learn, essentially. Okay, three ways that we learn. One is through our five senses. And they're fallible. Right? Our vision is fallible. You're up in an airplane, you look down, everything looks miniature. It's not miniature, it just looks miniature. If I close my eyes and say, okay, everybody's gone. They're not gone. Everybody's still here. So these are the five senses, and we all recognize that they have their limits, and they're fallible. So that's the first way. The second way is through our aql. The second way is through our aql. And the aql also has its limitations. The aql also has its limitations. Shaytan was using his aql to do this qiyas. This was his intellect at work. So the third way is through wahi. Is through the revelation. And the important thing to remember is that when the intellect contradicts the wahi rules out. Always. And without exception. Yeah, if the intellect is in line with the wahi, no problem. But when it contradicts the wahi, now the wahi takes over. And we reject that portion of the intellect. So Shaytan was the first person to do qiyas. And this is what he basically said, is he used his intellect to supersede wahi. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one, Allah never said that he was necessarily better than him. He simply said to do sajda. Then Shaytan went to this whole thing, well, the sajda means that he's better than me and I'm better than him and I made a fire and he made a dirt and look at where we ended up. This is what he did. He basically took the intellect and he put it above the wahi. And we do this. I'll tell you, we do this a lot. So we need to be very, very careful about it. Okay, so this was the second thing. This was the second trend-setting Shaytan. The third thing is that Shaytan is the first example of somebody who spent his life doing good things, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through one mistake, in an instant, he lost all of that. And we mentioned the hadith about the tongue, that a person gets to the door of Jannah, and then through a single word that he says is distasteful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's thrown 70 years into the fire. So from here, we really need to take the lesson that we always need to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thank Him for everything that He's given us. Because we've made these mistakes. We've disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've been arrogant in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's only through His mercy that we didn't end up like Shaytan. So we always need to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this. And we always need to make the dua that whenever our end comes, that it comes on iman. That it comes on iman. So this was the third thing. And so the fourth thing was, like I mentioned, that Shaytan was the first person to put the intellect above revelation. He was the first person to put the intellect above revelation. And in all four of these things here, what you find is that Shaytan did them to start, and now we made them our way. So now you find people breaking the ijma. Now you find people using their intellect to do qiyas in ways that they shouldn't be doing, that are incorrect, that the Sharia does not accept. There are people that live their life the way they're supposed to, and then they make a few mistakes and they lose everything. They lose everything. And then we take our intellect and we put it above the wahi. When the new scientific discovery comes out and it doesn't seem to fit with the Sharia, what do? We say, well, maybe that part of Islam is not right. Maybe we didn't understand that properly. The ulama don't know what they're talking about. Science says it's this way. Right? So we've taken these things. Shaitan was the first one to do them, and now we've taken them and we've made them our way. So now it's very important to realize that when Shaitan attacks people, first and foremost, he wants them to fail in the same way that he failed. So he wants us to make the same mistakes that he made. Which is why he comes and he attacks the prayer. He hates it when we do sajda. Because that's what he couldn't do. That's what he couldn't do. When we make a mistake, what does he want us to do? To become arrogant about it. To stand with pride. And say, no, nothing wrong, it's not a big deal, I'm fine. Because that's what he did. So you should recognize every single mistake that Shaytan made, that's the first thing he's going to attack you with. That's the first thing that he's going to attack you with. Because he wants you to fail in exactly the same way. Misery loves company. Misery loves company. And so does Shaytan. And this is what he made his goal. So we mentioned that Shaytan was an alim. He was very knowledgeable. And Shaytan was an abid. He was a worshipper. So what was it that Shaytan didn't have that would have saved him from his mistake? Because we also, right? There are people here, we came for the ilm, right? People came here to study, to take their exam, to get their next lessons, to move on. We're recommending everybody do extra ibadah while you're here in the masjid. Become an alim. Become an abid. But we are adding a third thing. Become an ashik. Become a lover of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then all you care about is His pleasure. All you care about is His pleasure. Then when He says something, you jump to do it. Without questioning, without thinking about it. That's the third thing. Alim, abid, ashiq. A lover of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what the Sahaba were. They were crazy mad in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would do anything they could to get on the musalla. The only reason they didn't is because they had to fulfill their obligations. And why? Because Allah wanted them to. Allah made it fard to provide for their family, so they provided for their family. They could have stopped and said, you know what, isn't it better if I just stay on the musalla and worship Allah? Doesn't Allah want people to worship Him? Right? So they didn't make this mistake. They did not allow their aql to come above the wahi. Allah says, work, provide for your family. We're going to work, provide for our family. And Allah says, when you have time for rest, use it for ibadah. We'll use it for ibadah. So simple. We've just complicated the matter. And obviously, Shaitan is coming at us day and night, attacking and attacking. So another thing to realize is that even Shaitan, when he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was granted one request. he was granted a respite. And if Shaitan was granted a respite, then there is not a single person in this room that if he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, that he will not be granted a respite. Because Shaitan was very sincere when he asked for that. He was very sincere when he asked for that. Because that was his last hope. That was his last ditch effort. So when you realize that you have gone so far away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do, when you realize that all that is left for you is a last ditch effort, and then you sit on the musalla and the tears flow from your eyes, and you explain to Allah and you tell Allah and you cry to Allah that I'm worthless and I know I'm worthless, but you are great, and your mercy is never ending, and you make that last ditch effort, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from you. And He takes you out of that state. And He takes you out of that state. So how do we defend against shaitan? Right, we talked about how we defend against the nafs. How do we defend against shaitan? So the first thing is we need to understand, one that we mentioned, shaitan is going to use the same tricks that got him into trouble. Okay? That's the first thing. The second thing is shaitan has no shame. Shaitan has absolutely no shame. He will go after anybody at any moment about anything. About anything. And how do we know this? Because who did he go after? The Prophet of Allah. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to us that I was in the prayer. Now can you imagine this scene? Allah, Lord of the worlds, and the best of His creation, communing with Him in the best of ways. In that scenario, Shaitan says, I'm going to get him. I'm going to get him. This is his... He has no shame. He has absolutely no shame. That he thinks he can get the Prophet of Allah, even in in a moment when he's not communing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that direct fashion. There's no way. But what does he do? He waits till he's in the prayer and he says, I'm going to go after him now. And so the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Shaitan came and he tried, what did he try to do? To get me to break off my prayer. I'm communing with my Lord. I'm in the place that I love to be. I am the best of creation. And Shaitan is coming and he's trying to get me to break off my prayer. So what did the Prophet of Allah do? He grabs him by the neck and he starts to choke him. He grabs him by the neck and he starts to choke him. And he said that I was thinking that I would tie him to the pillar for everybody to see, and then the Prophet of Allah decided that he wouldn't do that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his wisdom. So this is shaitan. No shame. Anybody he will go after at any time. When you're weak, he will go after you. When you're strong, he will go after you. When you're in the prayer, he will go after you. When you're out of the prayer, he will go after you. There is not a single situation, there's not a single dirty place. He will come after you when you're sitting at home. He will come after you if you go in the bathroom. He doesn't care where it is. He has no shame. All he cares about is getting you. And when your enemy is that determined, you need to reciprocate that. You need to reciprocate. The same fervor that Shaitan is coming after you with, you need to be chasing after Allah. The same way he's coming after you, you need to go after Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Shaitan this ability. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave him that respite. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who can control him. He can't do anything except that Allah wants him to. So what do? You turn to Allah. You say, A'udhu billah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. Not A'udhu minash shaitan rajim. Not I seek refuge from shaitan. We don't seek refuge from shaitan. I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because my seeking refuge is, what can I do? I'm worthless. I'm pitiful. But Allah is the greatest. It's nothing for Allah. And so when you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that way with sincerity, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you against shaitan. So that's one of the ways. Another thing to realize about shaitan is that he will wait for just the right moment. He's very, very, very patient. And so there's a hadith that says that shaitan sits facing the heart of the believer. He sits with his mouth facing the heart of the believer. Because as long as the dhikr is happening, shaitan has no power. When the adhan is being called, he runs away, and then he comes back. When the iqama is called, he runs away, and then he comes back. So he sits with his mouth facing your heart, and he waits for the minute that your heart is not in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he attacks. So how do we protect ourselves? Easy. Keep your heart busy in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then shaitan will just sit there forever, and he'll never get a moment. He'll never get an opportunity to attack your heart. So you have to use dhikr to fight back. Shaitan can't handle the dhikr. It's too much for him. Because what is a dhikr? It's turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's reminding shaitan that you don't have any power. The only reason you're even here now is because Allah gave you a respite, and Allah can take that away whenever He wants. Who's going to stop Allah from doing that? So that's what the dhikr does. It just gets shaitan right in the heart. He just can't take it. So what else does shaitan do? Shaitan attacks you when your defenses are down. And how does he do this? So for example, it comes in the hadith that when we go to sleep, that shaitan makes three knots. And what does he do? As you're going into bed, he says to you, you have a long night ahead of you, so sleep tight. This is what he says. You have a long night ahead of you, so sleep tight. And so we know from the hadith how we break that. Right? So one is that when we wake up, we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is that we do wudu. Then the second knot is broken. And the third is that we pray two rakat. And that's why we pray those first two rakat quickly, to get the knot broken, to remove shaitan's. Okay, so what does shaitan do? He comes and makes you want to sleep more. So he basically comes, he ties these knots. He says, don't worry about it. Plenty of time to rest. You can sleep for 8 hours and still get up for Fajr, no problem. He puts you to bed. He basically comes and he puts you to bed. And then what happens? You don't wake up for Fajr. And then what does he do? To add insult upon injury, he urinates in your ear. He's the one who causes you to miss the Fajr. And then what does he do? He urinates in your ear. He adds insult to injury. This is shaitan. This is the enemy that we're facing. And the last point about shaitan, we don't have time to go over the hadith necessarily, but basically, your shaitan is going to be your equivalent. Okay? Your shaitan is going to be your equivalent. Meaning that if you're an engineer, your shaitan is an engineer. If you are a doctor, your shaitan is a doctor. So he knows all the tricks. He knows all the things in that feel that you know. So much so that the ulama have written that the shaitan of the alim is an alim. That the shaitan of an alim is an alim. And that's why he's so good at it. He is your equal in every way. So obviously the only way to save ourselves is to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His mercy. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To get our hearts alive with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's one last thing that I'll leave you to remember with. Because it seems like shaitan is kind of unsurmountable. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala realized that we would come to this thought in the end. That how can we defeat him? It's hopeless. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inni ibadi laysa laka sultan. That there is nobody who can have reign over my believers, the worshippers. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically telling you is that shaitan may have the ability to trick you a little bit, but he does not have the ability to make you fall into something that cannot be forgiven. So he may make you miss Fajr. All you have to do is turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincerely make istighfar, make tawbah, promise not to do it again, and then you'll be forgiven. So anything that shaitan can pull you into are only those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for. Beyond that, he doesn't have any power over you. So now, you know, like in The Wizard of Oz when they pull the sheet away from the guy and it's a little, right? Now we reveal Shaitan for what he is. Nothing. He's nothing. There's nothing, he has no power. إِنِّ إِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ سُلْطَانِ. He has no power. When we have Allah, what is Shaitan going to do? When we have Allah, what is our nafs going to do? Everything just falls into line at that point. And the way that we get Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be ours is by remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more and more that you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more and more that you work on your heart and you bring it back to life, you will protect yourself from these things. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes your guardian, becomes your friend, like he says in the Quran, then nobody can touch you. It may seem like it externally. There may be trials and tribulations that come upon you. The Prophet suffered the most trials and tribulations of anybody. Outwardly. Inwardly, they were in love with their Lord. When Prophet Yunus was in the belly of the whale, he was so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because he knew that that's where Allah wanted him to be. And he knew that his Lord would not forsake him. So we also have to know this. That is not reserved just for the prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forsake the believers. If we do our part, Allah will surely do his part. We just have to make that effort. We just have to make those first few steps, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open up doors for us. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ